quiet dawn.
You just entering the room and saying hello would be kind of thrilling.
Father dawn, to the
that he was able to rise to such heights and never lose sight of from whence he had come. That was tremendously impressive.
He sacrificed his career and lost his way of life for what he believed in, and that was unusual.
Today, for him to be one of the least known Americans shows the power of erasure that the United States government and the media was able to do to him.
When you shall these unlucky deeds relate, speak of me as I am. Nothing extenuate, nor set down aught in malice.
Quiet dawn.
I certainly come here every year on Paul Robeson's birthday, April 9th. It is a pilgrimage on my part. Not that I could forget him. It makes my life more complete in a way. He was a great human being. He was a great artist. He was a great fighter for my people, for our people. He was a great fighter for peace. He was a beautiful human being.
What is America to me? A name, a map of a flag I see. A certain word, a democracy.
One of America's greatest 20th century heroic figures who was loved all over the world has been all but forgotten in his own country. Paul Robeson was a victim of McCarthyism and his own integrity. He challenged both white and black American establishments, and for his pains has been largely written out of the history books. Robeson's story is an American tragedy, and in its retelling, there's an opportunity to discover what he meant to America and for Americans to reclaim him as one of their own.
Robeson is many things to many people. And so when you delve into his memory, you delve into the controversies and conflicts that exist around his memory.
I'm an anti-fascist, and I would feel, perhaps, that any war against the Soviet Union would be a fascist war.
When you mention that he was linked to the Soviet Union, you get looks of disbelief, confusion, and ultimately people turn off, because Americans associate communism with failure and also with being somehow hopelessly out of tune with American life.
When we talk of Robeson, we have to talk about this other development. That's what I call national Alzheimer's disease. No past. Robeson being condemned is long forgotten. In fact, most kids, including black kids, don't know who Robeson was.
Some students know because their families have made him available in some form. Some students have no idea at all, and they come here meeting him for the first time. It wasn't until I started working at Paul Robeson High School that I really discovered who he was. A part of me was somewhat surprised, somewhat annoyed, somewhat angry. I didn't know how large he was in the world.
Everybody should know who Paul Robeson is. He's very famous for his singing and his acting. He sung with his heart and his soul. He told me that he was not going to give up, even though the race was hard.
I'm very proud to be going to a school that bears his name, and I feel that more people need to be educated about Paul Robeson and his life.
We get to pass this down to generation to generation. And like when we tell our, like when we get older, we're gonna tell our children about who Paul Robeson was.
In 1973, Paul Robeson was found by a panel of black historians who wanted to know who are the 10 greatest black men in American history. So I took the magazine to Paul. I always like to bring him good news, different things. Look at this, Paul. You're listed now as one of the 10 greatest blacks in America. But Paul thought about it a minute. He said, well, Pop would have been proud. I laughed at that because I thought to myself, even here, now, here's a man who's in his 70s, and yet he's still looking at to do things that his father would approve of.
You know, you're the first people that have said, is this the house where Paul Robeson lives? Nobody has ever knocked on the door before. People have been astonished and amazed and pleased when I've told them, but nobody's come.
Paul Robeson was born in 1898. His father was a runaway slave who worked his way through college to become a minister in a black Presbyterian church in Princeton, New Jersey. His popularity became threatening to Princeton's conservative white community, and eventually they had him removed from his ministry.
He had lived in the corner house, and they came here then, so they were fairly unhappy about being in this house to start with. And apparently he just did odd jobs until they relocated.
His father's story was a story of triumph over enormous odds. His mother died through a tragic accident when Paul was five.
She was cooking and a spark flew up and caught her sleeve and caught the dress on fire and burned her. And my elderly neighbors next door who were here said that you could hear it. She died about 3 days later.
Paul's gifts and talents and the largeness of his spirit were very early recognized. He was well taken care of even after his mother died. They knew that this was a boy who was going to achieve great things.
Robeson of Rutgers, that was the name. I didn't know Paul. I didn't know anything about him except that he was Robeson of Rutgers, who was said to be the greatest football player in America.
In 1915, Robeson wins a scholarship to Rutgers University. He's only the third black student in the college's history. An outstanding talent, he collects honors both in the classroom and on the sports field.
When Robeson tried out for the football team at Rutgers, some of his fellow teammates were determined that he not make the squad.
Before you know it, one fellow hits me in the nose, and my nose is bleeding and bloody, and another fellow breaks my shoulder.
They beat him up so badly that he was in bed for 10 days. The second scrimmage, somebody, you know, put a cleat through his hand.
And takes my nails off of my hand, and they're bleeding.
That time, he got enraged.
As far as I'm concerned, I'm going to kill him!
He picked the guy up over his head as if he was going to throw him to the ground. And he was stopped only by the intervention of the coach, who just yelled out, Robeson has made the team.
Josh fit the battle of Jericho, Jericho,
oh, yes.
Jericho.
Oh, bad, Josh fit the battle of Jericho.
His prowess as a football player brings him national recognition. He's twice picked for the All-American team.
Josh fit the battle of Jericho, and the walls come tumbling down.
Good morning, brother Pilgrim. Pray tell me where you found.
After graduating with high honors from Rutgers, Robeson moves to New York where he studies to become a lawyer. Here he meets and marries a young student, Islanda Good.
On this enchanted ground,
that morning, Josh fit the battle of
Jericho. Prejudice at his law firm prompts Robeson to rethink his direction, and encouraged by Essie, he decides on a professional stage career.
Josh fit the battle of Jericho, Jericho, Jericho. Josh fit the battle of Jericho, and the walls come.
Playwright Eugene O'Neill offers him the leads in two plays, All God's Chillin' Got Wings and The Emperor Jones.
At the Battle of Jericho.
He also teams up with the ranger and accompanist Lawrence Brown to perform concerts of Negro spirituals.
Those three achievements happening almost simultaneously skyrocketed his fame. so that he was almost immediately deluged with offers of every kind, both theatrical and concert offers.
In 1928, Robeson stars in Showboat. The musical establishes his international career, and while still giving performances in the States, he spends much of the next 12 years in London.
He just keeps rolling, he keeps on rolling.
It's here, alongside Peggy Ashcroft's Desdemona, he becomes the first black actor ever to play Othello with a white cast. On the silver screen, he's to make an even bigger impact.
In the 1930s, Paul Robeson was one of the most popular stars of British films. His personality, you know, was such that the British cinema audiences, you know, flocked to the cinema to see him.
In Saunders of the River, Robeson plays a tribal chief. Far from portraying the values of African culture, the film revels in the glories of empire.
Monrovia. 5 months ago, you made yourself chief of the Ockeries. Didn't you know that no man can be chief in the river territories without my permission?
I knew, Lord. Well? Well, I also knew that you also knew that I made myself chief of the Ockery.
You knew that I knew because of my magic.
Lord, I knew that you knew by your spies were everywhere and were called the eyes of your lordship.
Thought I would like you so much that I would...
Saunders of the River was a tremendous disappointment to him because... He was led to believe by the producer that African life and culture was going to be presented on the screen in a positive light, and this was not the case. You know, Robeson was perhaps a little naive to think that, but then Robeson was at the beginning of his commercial film career.
But Robeson greatly values the friendships he makes amongst the film's extras. Many are Africans studying in London. They encourage his interest in his own African roots and his lifelong involvement in African culture and politics.
He says it was in London that I discovered Africa. It was in London that he met African students. It was in London that he studied African languages. It was in London that he met important political figures. London was an extremely exciting place intellectually and politically in the late 1920s and throughout the 1930s.
A year later, Song of Freedom more successfully articulates his growing cultural and political concerns.
It's always Africa, isn't it, John?
After all, that's my home. That's where we come from. I wonder which part. I'm always wondering. Perhaps there. Or there. What wouldn't I give to know?
By the late 30s, Paul Robeson had begun to break away from the kind of concert halls that he was appearing in. He felt that he was performing to the upper classes, people that could only afford to see him. And he then started to tour cinemas and music halls because he wanted to reach the working class people.
He saw the miners in the 30s walking through the streets of London. He recognized straight away the principles of their struggle for better conditions, better money, and a better way of life.
The poverty, the unemployment, the deprivation that was happening in the valleys was very similar to some of the ghettos they had in America. He realized the politics of it all as well, that they were fighters for their class and for their communities, exactly the same as him.
Proud Valley, made in 1939, is the film he's happiest with. Set in a mining community in South Wales, it reflects Robeson's empathy with the working classes and forges his lifelong bond with the Welsh people.
The miners also treated him as somebody who was part of their world and appeared to welcome people of African descent in that world in a way that he almost never saw in the United States. And it really made a very powerful impression upon him.
The night overhead, the stars are shining. Soviet motherland.
The 30s are the defining years for Robeson's political beliefs. He'd already visited Moscow to discuss making a film with the director Eisenstein and seen there the social benefits of communism. Like many intellectuals, he becomes an outspoken admirer of the Soviet Union.
I've spoken many times about my first trip to the Soviet Union in 1934. For the first time, as I stepped on Soviet soil, I felt myself a full human being. A full human being.
The Soviet Union is the only government to rally to the Republican cause when civil war flares in Spain. From Europe and America, volunteers form international brigades to fight fascism. Playing his part, Robeson flies out to sing at the front line.
Far and wide as the eye can wander, heath and bog are everywhere.
There he was in the midst of destruction and war, singing to us. And the moment he stopped singing, we could hear once again the bullets, the bombing, the shells, and all the pertinences of war. But it was a civilizing thing.
Witnessing the bravery and passion of the young troops, Robeson resolves to become more politically active.
He was an artist who had decided that the whole purpose of his art would be to make politics, to improve the lot of so-called ordinary people, and especially, of course, people of color around the world.
At the outbreak of the Second World War, Robeson brings his family home. He returns a star. True to his roots, the first concert he gives is at his brother's church in Harlem.
Paul Robeson's brother was pastor of this church for many years. When Paul was in New York, this was the home church for him. Often he sang to raise money for the church. Other times he just came to be with his people.
Being a black African woman, it was great, you know, just to be around him.
I think he was the greatest man at his time of all time, one of the greatest educators of all time.
The voice, the volume he gave me was just awesome. It was awesome. He was very good.
I remember one time a friend of mine, a Jewish friend of mine, wanted to meet him, and we were backstage after, between, you know, song, and I introduced him to her, and he kissed her hand, and she said, "I'm not going to wash my hands for another whole week."
Out of the cheating, out of the shouting, out of the murders.
By 1940, Robeson is at the peak of his fame. He records Ballad for Americans for CBS Radio. The public response is huge. In 1942, he revisits Othello, which becomes the longest-running Shakespeare play on Broadway. But despite his star status, there are reminders enough of his real place in society.
He visited a Park Avenue apartment, and the doorman told him that he could get to that apartment by way of the freight elevator. And Robeson said, "That may be your idea of a Negro's way to heaven, but it's not mine. The party's being given in my honor." So he was allowed to go up the regular elevator. But the incidents of that kind repeated over and over again.
Robeson's stand for the rights of his people is unequivocal. he meets with Truman to demand an end to the lynchings of blacks in the South. He refuses to perform in segregated theaters, and on the picket line, he protests against the segregationist Jim Crow laws.
In this theater, no Negroes are allowed in any part of it. And I am here in the picket line with the National Association for the Advancement of Colored People to struggle against this unjust discrimination.
Paul Robeson inspired many youth on the college campuses and youth in the towns. And he did this by saying, I speak to you in the South because this is where the struggle must take place. And of course, this was prophetic.
Robeson is one of the few black leaders who sees that economics is the link between the struggle of black Americans and all working classes. He aligns himself with the labor movement, singing at rallies and on picket lines.
I dreamed I saw Joe Hill last night.
I've had a chance to meet human beings, to know them face to face, man to man. This is a unity, a complete unity of a kind between the Negro people and between the working classes of America and myself. So there's no longer this division. This is the great battle.
America meant so much to him. It was the people who worked in the mills and the cotton fields and the factories and the he saw on the street, who came to the concerts.
He was going to show through music that people of different races and colors and countries had the same dreams and expressed these dreams musically. And it was a very powerful message to present in musical terms. To say it in a speech is one thing, to sing it is another.
And standing there as big as life and smiling with his eyes.
I am today giving up my concerts for 2 or 3 years to enter into this struggle at a very, it's what I call getting into the rank and file struggle of my people for full citizenship in these United States. So I won't be singing except for the rights of my people for the next couple of years. No pretty songs, John. No pretty songs. We're
working men. Robeson is soon fighting on another front as Cold War hysteria sweeps the country. He testifies before a Senate hearing deliberating on whether Communist Party members should be made to register. He argues that the question is a violation of his civil liberty.
Am I a communist? The Communist Party, Senator Ferguson, is a legal party. I have as much right to be a member of the Communist Party as I have to be of the Republican or the Democratic Party. But in protecting the civil rights of all Americans, it's none of your business.
With scant regard for his reputation back home, Robeson visits Moscow and shows his friendship for America's enemy. He tours factories, meeting the workers, and giving concerts for them.
He was a Democrat. He was fighting for the people in the street, for their interests, for the rights of the proletariat, and so certainly all these things made Paul Robeson a hero in Russia.
Ну как он был как мы
из рабочих, да. Мы такие же из рабочих, поэтому он, по-моему, понимал, да, и понимал и нас,
и мы его поняли, да. Когда он к нам приезжал.
Тем более он был за мир.
Мы долго все обсуждали в школе этот концерт. Это было очень необычно, потому что мы никогда до этого не слышали по радио вообще песни зарубежных певцов. От моря и до моря, подъем, обеньком,
народ трудовой, народ боевой. Его принимали с большой радостью,
его очень любили. Не только как певца, не только как фигуру выдающегося значения в рабочем движении. И поэтому его концерты превращались в значительное как-то место занимало в жизни, даже, я бы сказал, города.
Вы знаете, что я твердый, глубокий, истинный друг советского народа.
Before returning to the States, Robeson attends the World Peace Congress in Paris, where he calls on black Americans to fight for peace. His words are distorted by the media, implying, he said, black Americans wouldn't go to war against the Soviet Union. The reports provoke outbursts of anti-Robeson feeling.
This is the translation from the French transcript of what he said. We are determined to fight for peace. We do not wish to fight against the Soviet Union. That's what he said.
The headlines were to the effect that Robeson prefers Soviet Union to his own country. Robeson advises blacks never to take up arms against the Soviet Union, etc.
What his meaning was very clear, I think, that the fight for freedom for his people was here.
In 1949, there was no militant mood among black Americans. There were not black Americans prepared to rally around Robeson in significant numbers. So when you have a radical leader making a radical statement without the support of the masses, that leader is vulnerable.
It isn't just the American establishment turning the heat up on Robeson. Fearing further marginalization, black America disowns him. Baseball hero Jackie Robinson is asked to testify before the House Committee on Un-American Activities.
I've been asked to express my views on Paul Robeson's statements in Paris to the effect that American Negroes would refuse to fight in any war against Russia because we love Russia so much. I haven't any comment to make except that if Mr. Robeson actually made it, it sounds very silly to me.
Jackie was under pressure. He had to. The black leadership said he had to in order to take them off the spot to show that we are really loyal Americans. And so since Jackie was a hero of the time, and he was felt that he would be the most effective rebuttal to what Robeson had to say.
It was a hurtful thing to have Jackie Robinson, who was really a great hero of ours, I mean, for what he had accomplished, turn against Robeson because of what he was trying to achieve, when it would have seemed that they were both in the same battle and on the same side.
Paul said, if you're expecting me to criticize Jackie, I'm not going to do it. I'm not going to make any statements against Jackie whatsoever, because that's what they want us to do, to be fighting among ourselves. I'm not going to say anything negative about Jackie.
He's the kind of black person who scares the hell out of white America. And he'll never have forgiven him for that. They thought that he was their darling, that they had him because he was Othello. He was doing, you know, their thing. And then he turned around and stopped doing their thing, and they were offended and aghast at him. He was an ingrate. And he just kept on keeping on.
Simmering white fears boil over when Robeson attempts to sing at an open-air concert at Peekskill, New York. The first performance is canceled when violence is threatened. Undeterred, Robeson is back the following week.
He scandalized my name.
had a brother. No,
no, you call. I have a vivid memory of it, with Paul standing on a little platform, my children at his feet, because they weren't going to let anything happen to their Paul. And the ridge of hills around the concert ground was lined with young men from the unions who had come to defend their hero.
We congratulated ourselves that it had all gone smoothly. However, I remember wondering why cars left so slowly. And when finally our car got up to the gate, we found out why. Around the corner was a young man with a pile of stones about waist high, oh, some as big as a baseball. Wham! At every car that passed. Around the corner was another young fellow with another pile of stones. Wham! From the other side. Around the next corner was another. It must have been altogether 10 or 15 piles of stones within about a half a mile before we reached the state highway.
It was a vision of America which we had never seen before. It was very well organized, and that was frightening.
I said, "Officer, aren't you going to do something?" He just said, "Move on, move on." In other words, he knew all about it.
Paul was very upset, but he realized, as did we all, that we were in for difficult times ahead.
In 1950, after Robeson refuses to stem his criticism of the treatment of black Americans during his overseas visits, the Department of State withdraws his passport. He's told such matters are a family affair. For the next 8 years, Robeson is caged within United States borders. A prisoner in his own country, he suffers increasing public scorn and isolation.
He was banned from television. He was banned from film. He was banned from radio. He was banned from the theater. And then the
Holy Spirit. In our home, people I had grown up with didn't want to know him or be in the same room as he was.
By 1950, no union in the United States, other than a handful of unions with left-wing leadership, would invite Robeson to do anything that involved their membership. And pray like Paul, go home and tell your
neighbor he died to save. He was a pariah. He was a leper. He was a moral, political leper. How was he treated? My God. When I say he became a non-person, it's literal. Never talked about unless it was in a pejorative manner.
Every now and then he'd be depressed, but he had a way of studying, or he'd sit at the piano and tinkle, and he sort of lived from place to place, looking for warmth and security.
We're at Jumel Terrace, a house that Paul lived in. And while he lived here, he was, in effect, confined by the United States government, could not leave the United States.
More soul-destroying than confinement, Robeson sees the gulf widening between himself and the mainstream black community.
It seemed to me that there was something corrupt in this period when so many of the African American leaders in the major civil rights organizations were silent during this period and were cowed by the general terror in the country.
Imagine, somewhere somebody says, I, born a Negro, that because of my beliefs, my fight for peace, my fight for friendship between nations, my fight for the complete liberation of my people, that somewhere I'm not an American and that I should be cut off from the very people from whom I was born.
In trying to cultivate support amongst the white establishment, Robeson's uncompromising stand actually works in favor of the black leadership.
It made their job much easier. They could now say to their powerful white friends, you know, you really better deal with us, because if you don't, look who's waiting in the wings. Paul Robeson, pro-communist, rabble-rouser, darling of the black masses.
The students who were members of the National Association for the Advancement of Colored People, they'd wanted to put on a concert with Robeson in 1952. And then they were told by the Washington office of the organization, your charter will be taken away from you if you sponsor Robeson in a concert. I told this to Paul around 1957 or 58. A kind of grim smile went over his face. He said, well, those are the people who did the final hatchet job on me.
Even a confined Robeson is considered a threat.
Not only did the FBI track Robeson, as far as I can tell, pretty much on a daily basis, but they also opened his mail and they tapped his phone.
We always felt that he was in danger. He didn't travel anywhere by himself. Sometimes I thought it was a little silly that somebody my size would be like a bodyguard for Paul.
There were a couple of incidents which remained very shadowy, in which Robeson came very close to having a fatal accident.
The guy at the Chevrolet place told me, he says, you know, it's a good thing you brought this car in. He says, A-frame. He says, that would give away and you would swerve right into oncoming traffic. Who was working on this?
If there is incriminating evidence about, say, a literal plot to kill Robeson, we probably will never get most of the details because that evidence was probably destroyed.
I think in Paul there was a deep sadness. And it increased every now and then when he felt really deterred from singing or appearing or acting or talking in public places.
One of the happy days of that period was when we flew from here to the state of Washington to a place called Peace Arch Park. It's on the border with Canada. We had about 25, 50 people on our side and tens of thousands of Canadians on the other side of the border. I don't think that ever happened in history before that a concert was sung by a man in one country physically while his audience was in another country.
I wish I could go on all day, but I wanted to thank you again in coming here today. And I have just received an invitation to appear at the Eisteddfod in October, given by the miners and by the workers of Wales, and I hope to be able to get there to do that. Didn't my
Lord deliver? Robeson isn't allowed to leave, but technology throws him a lifeline. Down a transatlantic phone, he sings to the miners gathered in South Wales.
I can't tell you what it means to hear you like this. It seems as though I'm really standing there right with you, and I can see many of my old friends.
Why the moon her watch is keeping all through the night.
The gathering in the Porthcawl Pavilion was electrified by it. It was a man's voice, unseen. As far as we were concerned at the time, unsafe, and we didn't know his destiny. But here he was alive. His voice told us that.
The moon, her watch is keeping all through the night.
Although heartened by his friends abroad, there's little to encourage Robeson back home. During his years of isolation, it's from some of the black churches that he finds the warmest welcome. Here he can still perform and find comfort.
It was here on June 1st, 1958, that Paul Robeson's last concert ever in the United States was sung in this church, on June 1st, 1958.
No more auction block for me. No more, no more. No more auction block for me.
2 weeks later, he got his passport, and in July, he had escaped.
Robeson is to spend the next 5 years away. He tours Europe before returning to Britain and to Othello at Stratford-upon-Avon.
I flew over for the opening, and it was a mighty triumph to have him walk onto that stage after all those years.
One terrible, difficult sound was my, almost at the beginning of the play, my services, which I have done the scenery, my services, services. I would say my services, I had to work on that very But later I took some special work at the University of London, and also in my university days I majored in English, and I have records from the earliest time, from time of Anglo-Saxons, matter of fact, through Chaucer. And and of course since I worked on my songs with Roger Quilter, and I would have to use drawl. I couldn't walk out here and say, drink to me only with thine eyes, and I will pledge with mine. It's got to be very, drink to me only with thine eyes, and I will pledge with mine. Or leave a kiss within the cup. You see what I mean?
He was received by the British people with enormous love and warmth, which I think restored his spirits a great deal.
Over the mountains and
nor has Robeson's star dimmed in the Soviet Union. Returning once more, he receives a hero's welcome.
I mean, the Russians were really showing their true love towards this person. I mean, nobody organized those demonstrations of love and respect. It was very sincere and very honest demonstration of the Soviet people's attitude towards this really outstanding personality.
В самом отдаленном уголке Узбекистана знали, кто такой Поль Робсон, что это великий певец, и ждали его с нетерпением. Я к нему подошла одна женщина, взяла его за руки и стала, значит, с ним так танцевать. Он всегда человек очень компанейский, откликающийся, и он не сказал, ой, что ты, ой, нет, я не буду, ой. Он взял ее тоже за руки, и они вместе с ним стали танцевать, делать, ну, какие-то шажочки, там, несколько, и публика была в восторге.
Every Soviet official certainly cherished every moment of mingling, so to say, with the Robesons. They considered it their duty and pleasure to talk to him, to invite him to parties, to be seen with Paul Robeson.
В Александровском замке был устроен прием для высоких гостей, которые отдыхали в это время в Ялте, и были приглашены и Поль, и Исланда, И они очень хорошо общались, разговаривали и с Хрущевым, и с Ниной Петровной, его женой. Поль Робсон, ведь он колоссального роста, а Никита Сергеевич Хрущев был маленького роста. И для того, чтобы лучше разговаривать, Хрущев забрался на большой такой камень-валун, и они стали вместе одного роста, что всех очень веселило, они очень смеялись, но, тем не менее, они разговаривали лицом к лицу, а до этого, значит, Робсон смотрел вот сюда, а Хрущев смотрел вот так вот. А когда он стал на камень, то они стали вровень.
It's never been clearly established how much Robeson knew about the darker side of the Soviet regime. He had several Jewish friends who were persecuted under Stalin, and despite state secrecy, some find it hard to believe that Robeson didn't suspect what was happening. Accounts are conflicting.
I'm absolutely sure he was dissatisfied with many things in Moscow, especially politically, but he never said in the open about anything he didn't like in Russia. And only in private he dared to mention the topics which were not really liked by the officials of Russia. He mentioned several times his worries about the fate of many people whom he knew personally, among them some persons of Jewish origin who were persecuted and still persecuted even after Stalin died.
When he returned from the Soviet Union, say in 1949, he denied that there was persecution. He believed that all of the national minorities in the Soviet Union were given equal rights. He said he saw them in leading positions. He saw them. He gave many examples of what and how he felt that this charge was ridiculous.
He knew that some of his Jewish friends were being sent to Gulag. He knew these things, but he refused to denounce the Soviet Union anyway because his mistrust of the American establishment was so great.
Even after Khrushchev denounced Stalin's crimes to the world in 1956, Robeson never publicly condemned the Soviet regime, a silence for which he's never been forgiven.
I think that's going to always be held against him. How could he be so smart and not realize that Stalin did this? And once Stalin was revealed, particularly by Khrushchev, why didn't he recant? And I think that that is a problem, certainly.
Robeson was a man who had been trained by his father to keep his feelings under wraps. But over the decades, these feelings accumulate. And I think what happened was that Robeson's world vision essentially came loose from its moorings.
During his time away, he suffers ill health and mental exhaustion, and he's hospitalized on several occasions. In 1963, a diminished Robeson returns to an America caught up in the swirl of the civil rights movement.
Did you just say how you feel to be back in the country?
I'm very glad to be back.
Let me out, please.
What are you going to do now, Mr. Robeson?
I'm going to be resting for a while.
Robeson, how do you feel about the civil rights movement here?
Did you take any activity, any part in the civil rights movement at all?
I've been a part of that all my life.
What about
he set it up in terms of the spirit of the whole thing, but then when it got down to the Martin Luther King, Malcolm X of it, he wasn't around, which always seemed to me tragic.
Paul didn't become involved because his health didn't permit it. He'd been hospitalized in Europe, and he just wanted to sit quietly at home, hoping to regain his strength.
They should have at least considered him an elder statesman or an emeritus person. But by that time, he had been so denounced and so discredited, nobody wanted King in particular, or Malcolm for that matter, wanted to associate what they were doing with anything that was directly considered communist. And by that time, he had been labeled.
Martin Luther King although he was privately quite sympathetic to Robeson, was too politically astute to dare associate with him in a public way.
To acknowledge his contribution, Robeson has to wait for a younger, more radical generation of black activists.
When Israel was in Egypt's land, let my people go.
There was a civil rights dinner in New York, and they said, oh, can you get Paul Robeson to come? That would be so wonderful.
We were very much aware of how the old guard black leadership in America and white political leadership in America treated Paul Robeson.
I remember John Lewis, with whom I had been on many a march, coming up to me and saying, could I possibly meet this man?
I remember saying to Paul Robeson, thank you, we admire you, we love you, thank you for standing up in order for us to stand up today.
Let my people go, no more shall they.
I wept. Paul was very touched.
He was not in the best of health, but he was there. He knew, he was very much aware of what was going on. He was very much aware that he was being honored.
Moses, way down in Egypt's land.
A lot of us walk around with underlying depressive disorders, and they never surface because we aren't subject to the kind of harassment and pressure that Robeson was on a daily basis, nor are we subject to the collapse of our visionary hopes for international socialism, as Robeson was.
The idea that a great figure has a mental illness does not fit well with the heroic narrative. In the end, Robeson didn't really win. I mean, he won in a sense that he stood by his values, but he didn't triumph in the end and become, you know, carried in victoriously to the arena.
He had one emotional breakdown in 1956, and then starting in 1960, you know, a series of breakdowns.
He was a man who had anger in him. And a lot of that anger probably was turned against himself, and these things triggered episodes of sadness which now and then afflicted him.
Psychologically, he was in such despair that at one point he actually slashed his wrists and attempted suicide. That episode happened in the Soviet Union in 1960.
After the death of his wife, Islanda, Robeson moves to his sister's house in Philadelphia. He's to spend his last 10 years here, a virtual recluse.
Sometimes I feel like a motherless child. Sometimes I feel like a motherless child.
He long ago told me that he was not going to be one of these people who don't know when it's time for him to get off the stage. If he can no longer be Paul Robeson, he is not going to appear in public at all.
Long ways from home. Come, my brother.
Many people throughout the world were not permitted to see him. Mrs. Forsythe, his sister, would stand at the entrance door and peep through the blinds and to make sure that the person was welcome.
Sometimes I feel like I'm almost.
He would light up when you came, and I would talk to him about the theater, and you could see him glow. But those periods were few and far between, I think.
A long ways. is from home, a long ways from home.
The last time he was here was his funeral. That was January 27th, 1976. And the church was filled. All of Harlem came. It was a rainy, drizzly day, as if nature itself was mourning on this occasion. These are the concluding words that I said in my eulogy on that occasion. How fortunate we were to have had Paul Robeson walk the earth among us. As artist and man, he was a prophetic vision of how wondrously beautiful the human race may yet become. Now he belongs to the future.
I wonder if people are beginning to realize what they lost really in those bad years. They lost a great American hero, I think. It's one thing to celebrate him 23 years or 22 years after he died, but it's another thing to have missed that voice and that presence all those years.
I want to cross over. Oh, don't.